jealous for me. Love's like a hurricane. I am a tree bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy.
It's good to see y'all tonight, and glad that you've come to this time of worship together. It's just good to be in God's house. This song tonight just reminds us that God has called us to be his children. It's amazing to think that God calls us to be his friends. So would you stand and let's sing together about how God calls us to be his friends. It's amazing that he thinks about us. Let's give him the praise he deserves. Sing with me.
Who am I that you are mindful of me? That you hear me when I call? Is it true that you are thinking of me? How you love me? It's amazing. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. He calls me friend. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. He calls me friend. Who am I that you are mindful of me, that you hear me when I call, when I call home? Is it true that you are thinking of me, how you love me? It's amazing. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. He calls me friend. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. He calls me friend. God all.
Call me friend. Hallelujah, Jesus. I'm a friend of God. Oh, I'm a friend of God. I'm a friend of God. You call me friend. One more time. I'm a friend of God. Oh, I'm a friend of God. I'm a friend of God. You call me friend.
Amazing to think that God calls us to be his children. The scripture talks about how great a love that God has lavished upon us, that we should be called the children of God. It's amazing to think that God calls us to be His children because He loves us so much.
Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend. Who would have thought that a Lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, you rescue the souls of men. You are the one that we praise. You are the one.
So tonight, even as we sing this last song, may it be our heart's desire to say, Lord, I give you everything, because that's what you desire.
This is my desire to honor you, Lord, with all my heart, I worship. I give you praise. All that I adore is in you. Lord, I give you my heart. I give you my soul. I live for you alone. Every breath that I take, I'm away. Lord, have your way in me. This is my desire to walk. I live for you alone. Every breath that I take, every moment I'm away, Lord, have your way in me.
Just in this hour, but every moment. Help us, Lord, to give ourselves to you, to learn what it means to surrender, because we have been bought with a price. We're not our own. We are yours. We praise you, Lord. We give you this time. Lord, please lead us, guide us as we worship and as we hear your word speak to our hearts. We ask it all in Jesus' name.
Good evening, Kelleytown. It is good to see you here tonight. Got a great crowd for our Wednesday night refuel service, and I am so thankful that you are here and that you came to fellowship and encourage and love on one another and to spend time in worship through song and through the preaching of God's word. A couple things. Operation Christmas Child, if you are preparing boxes to bring, they are due by Sunday, this coming Sunday, the 14th. Next Monday, so the 15th, we begin, as we have historically in the past, we are a collection center for this area. And so Monday the 15th through Monday the 22nd, we are going to open up our facilities during certain hours. On Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday, it's in the evenings. And so we need a few people to come up and help on those days. And then I think on Thursday and Friday and Saturday, it's during the day. Is that right, Miss Tansy? I don't remember off the top of my head. Okay. And so we do have some opportunities. We put the times out on our on Facebook, and we sent out an email about that. So if there's a way that you can come help in any of those times of receiving, we're going to need a couple of people inside kind of processing the boxes, because we have big boxes that Samaritan's Purse has given us, and we need to put them together, and then we'll put all the shoe boxes inside of them as they come in, and when that box gets full, we'll tape it up and put it aside so that on Monday the 22nd, we will come and we'll load all those up onto an 18-wheeler, and they will be transported to Florence to the church that Samaritan's Purse will come and pick them all up at. So we need some help next week during that. So if you've got some free time that you would like to donate to Operation Christmas Child, that would be a great help. One of the things that I know is always an issue with that is the shipping cost. And some people forget that it costs, and Samaritan's Purse asked that the people who are filling the boxes cover the shipping cost. And a couple years ago, as everything else did, that went up, and it's $9 a box. So don't forget that if you're packing a box or you're packing 10 boxes or whatever, to help take care of that shipping cost as well. Just throw that out as a reminder. But that's going on, so bring your boxes this coming Sunday. We got a lot of stuff that's going to be going on Sunday. We're going to be honoring our veterans on Sunday. We finalized some plans about that today, and so we're going to be doing that. But one of the things we're also going to be doing is, I don't know that we're going to have all the Christmas shoe boxes in here, but we've already got some, and they're going to be placed out along the platform. And during the worship service at 9 and at 10:30, we're just going to have a time of dedication and prayer over those boxes as we get ready to ship them out. So just to ask God to do something great through that. There are always millions of boxes that go out and thousands of kids that come to know Christ as a result of it. So I want to thank you for helping prepare those boxes and get all the stuff ready, and for what you've done. It's still time if you haven't. There's still time if you haven't done that yet to get that together and to put it together and bring it up here. Now, we won't have it by Sunday, but we do have a little bit of an advantage, and it cuts you just a little bit of slack since we are a receiving center and a local processing centers that you really have all of next week to get boxes in. So if the Lord puts it on your heart to do a few extra, then you can do that as well and just bring them up here sometime next week. But technically, the 14th is our last day to collect boxes. So, but just help out, pray over those as the Lord gives you remembrance of those things. Now, one of the cool things, there's a couple of different ways, and you actually, because of technology and how awesome it is when it works, but it's awesome when it does work, is that when you picked up one of those brochures that had, and you're going to decide whether you're going to give it to a little boy or a little girl and what age group, there's a QR code or some kind of barcode on there, and you can enter that information in, and you can actually track the boxes that you pack all the way to their destination to know where, what country and what area of that country it actually went to. And so that's a cool thing that they have added in the last couple of years. So if you're doing that and you want to know exactly where your box ends up, you have the ability to track that now. And then something that they added this year that I wasn't aware of is that if you're not able at this point in time to go do that, but you would still like to send a box, you can actually go onto the Operation Christmas Child website and you can just purchase a box. So I don't know how much that it tends. Do you know how much they, but there is an option that you can go on there and you don't have to go shop and you don't have to do all that stuff, and you can just pay and it will go out for you and you get all of that registration stuff done automatically. So that's just another way if you're interested and you want to participate but time got away from you or whatever, that you might be able to handle that as well. So I wanted to put that out there in front of you and just remind you, and we will be praying over those boxes on Sunday morning during our 9 o'clock and 10:30 worship service. There's something else that I wanted to present to you tonight. I met a guy when I was serving as pastor in North Carolina back in, I think I met Chris in 2014, 2015. We both went on to the board of directors for the North Carolina Baptist Convention at the same time, and we went through the training together, and we just became good friends. We served on the same committee in under the board of directors. We were on the evangelism committee for the North Carolina Baptist Convention for 4 years, and we just became very good friends. And Chris has been after me since day one of meeting him to go with him to India. He's been going to India for over 20 years, and when he goes, he goes in February. He spends 18 to 21 days over there, and they do a lot of neat things. But about 5 years ago, 6 years ago, the pastor that he was partnering with in India approached Chris because he had a great burden to reach the kids in India and wanted to do what we would call vacation Bible school. Now, they don't do it during the summertime. They do it whenever they can. But since 2017, they've seen over 170,000 kids come to know Christ in India. And what they don't know, because of the way that things are over there and that kind of stuff, is actually how many of the family members of those kids have come to know Christ. And I haven't been able to go with Chris to India yet, but he asked me several weeks ago now if our church would be interested in helping provide the VBS packets for the VBSs in India. And they do, of course, they can't cover the whole country, but they got about, I think it's 8 or 10 different regions that they go in right now. They're looking to add 5 more regions. And what they're wanting to do, they're trying to raise the money to purchase 150,000 VBS packets. And they use the packets more than once. Each packet has the potential to reach 2 to 3 families. You can purchase 9 packets for $1. So they're trying to raise $16,700 to purchase the 150,000 packets that have the potential to reach about 450 to 500,000 kids and their families in 2022. Now, I've presented this information to some on our finance committee and some on our missions committee, and we're looking at making that a part of what our church does officially in the budget and all that kind of stuff for 2023. But they are right now in the final stages of trying to collect that $16,000. And they're getting close to it. And what I would like is for your permission to encourage our finance committee to let us use $2,500. Now, that is not a huge amount, but here's what $2,500 does. It buys 22,500 packets that has the potential to reach over 50,000 kids with the gospel of Jesus Christ. So that's a very small amount of money that has the potential to do an enormously eternal, awesome work. And so I don't think that that is a whole lot. And I'll just go ahead. I'm going to share this on Sunday. But Steve came up to me Monday night and said, "Hey, did you see the monthly report for October yet?" And I was like, "No, I've been out and I haven't seen it yet." Our offering for the month of October, our undesignated receipts was over $100,000. So praise the Lord. We need $72,000 a month in offering to reach our budget. And God is just doing a great work, and I am so thankful. And when he told me that, I just was absolutely amazed. And so we praise the Lord for what he's doing. But this is another one of those scenarios where we have the money to do it. And so if you're okay with that, if you're okay with us sending $2,500 to them to buy these packets, y'all okay with that? Okay. Then we're gonna move forward in doing that and getting them to help them reach that goal so they can get those 150,000 packets, and we'll just sit back and see what the Lord does through that. Chris is an amazing guy, and about 2 months ago he started doing a Zoom call every Thursday preaching to people in India through a translator, and in the last 2 months they've had over 300 people saved just on Thursday mornings on a Zoom call with him preaching to an interpreter to people in India. And so God has just anointed this guy, and he's a dear friend, and I just think that it's a great thing that we can get in on that in a very, from our perspective, small way. And yet I believe that God can do something absolutely amazing with that. And so I'll keep you updated as I get information from him about where we are in that process. And if that's something that you feel led to support in addition, we got a lot of stuff that's going on. Our Lottie Moon Christmas offering, we're fixing to start promoting that. And so I know there's only so many dollars, but what we can do with this in right now will just make a huge impact in eternity. And so I thank you for your permission to let us do that. Well, take your Bibles and turn to the book of 1 Peter chapter 2. 1 Peter chapter 2, and man, I am excited. the very first time that I preached and started through the book of 1 Peter, Brother Joe Willard came up to me at the end of that, and he said, "Well, I think you're kind of excited about working your way through this." And I was like, man, the more that I read this book and just begin to study parts of it, it is such a treasure. And I don't know how many times I've read it, but this is the first time that I've ever preached through it. And so I'm just so excited about what God has to say to us in this. And tonight we're going to be looking, our focal passage is going to be in verses 7, 8, and 9. And so, but if you are able, stand with me in honor of the reading of God's word. We're going to read all of 1 Peter chapter 2. The words are on the screen behind me if you don't have your copy of God's word with you tonight. But this is what the Bible says. Therefore, because of all of these things, so just let me say this. I would encourage you, because we're going to be still several weeks in even chapter 2, to go back maybe once before, between Wednesday and Wednesday, and just read chapter 1, just to keep those things, that therefore, that connection piece. Don't lose sight of what God the Holy Spirit says to us in chapter 1 as we make our way through chapter 2, because that laid the foundation for everything else that he's addressing. So don't lose sight of chapter 1. Therefore, putting aside all malice and all deceit and hypocrisy and envy and all slander, like newborn babes, long for the pure milk of the word, so that by it you may grow in respect to salvation. If you have tasted the kindness of the Lord, and coming to him as to a living stone, which has been rejected by men, but is choice and precious in the sight of God, you also, as living stones, are being built up as a spiritual house for a holy priesthood, to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. For this is contained in Scripture: behold, I lay in Zion a choice stone, a precious cornerstone, and he who believes in him will not be disappointed. This precious value then is for you who believe. But for those who disbelieve, the stone which the builders rejected, this became the very cornerstone, and a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense. For they stumble because they are disobedient to the word. And to this doom they were also appointed. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for God's own possession, so that you may claim the excellencies of him who has called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. For you once were not a people, but now you are the people of God. You had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. Beloved, I urge you as aliens and strangers to abstain from fleshly lusts which wage war against the soul. Keep your behavior excellent among the Gentiles, so that in the things in which they slander you as evildoers, they may be, because of your good deeds as they observe them, glorify God in the day of visitation. Submit yourselves for the Lord's sake to every human institution, whether to a king as the one in authority or to the governors as sent by him, for the punishment of evildoers and the praise of those who do right. For such is the will of God, that by doing right you may silence the ignorance of foolish men. Act as free men, and do not use your freedom as a covering for evil, but use it as bond slaves of God. Honor all people, love the brotherhood, fear God, honor the king. Servants, be submissive to your masters with all respect, not only to those who are good and gentle, but also to those who are unreasonable. For this finds favor if, for the sake of conscience towards God, a person bears up under sorrows when suffering unjustly. For what credit is there if, when you sin and are harshly treated, you endure it with patience? But if when you do what is right and suffer for it, you patiently endure it, this finds favor with God. For you have been called for this purpose, since Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example for you to follow in his steps, who committed no sin, nor was any deceit found in his mouth. And while being reviled, he did not revile in return. While suffering, he uttered no threats, but kept entrusting himself to God, who judges righteously. And he himself bore our sins in his body on the cross, so that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. For by his wounds you were healed. For you were continually straying like sheep, but now you have returned to the shepherd and guardian of your souls. May God add a blessing to the reading and hearing of his word. Father, we love you. We thank you for your word. Speak to us now, and I pray that we'd never be the same. I pray that we would embrace joyfully and enthusiastically and deliberately what you want to do in us and what you want to do through us. God, time is short, and I pray that we would be found faithful. We love you. We thank you for loving us the way that you do, and it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Thank you, and you can be seated. So we get down, and 7, 8, and 9, but in verse 6, in verse 5, we're reminded that it's Jesus. This is all about Jesus. He is the living stone. He is the cornerstone. A cornerstone is something that they put in place, and they tied everything into the cornerstone. The greatest amount of energy and effort in building in the day in which Jesus lived was concerning the cornerstone. Because if they got, listen, if they got the cornerstone in the right place, everything else fit together the way that it was supposed to. Folks, your life will never fit together the way that it's supposed to in Jesus without Jesus, the cornerstone, being in the right place. And we looked even Sunday about you're either, Jesus is either in the right place or you're sitting in his seat. If Jesus is there, then you're in the right position, which is going to be before him, humbled and worshiping him. But if you're not humbled before the Lord, worshiping him, then you have gotten up and you have removed him from the place that he rightly deserves to be in your life, which this is what it means in the context of what we're looking at tonight, that you are determining in those moments, in those times, in those situations and days in your life that you are the cornerstone of your own life. And that everything needs to be fitted together to you. And that is a house that may be built, but Jesus said that at the right time and at the right place, thank you, sir, that a storm is going to come and you're not going to have a foundation, and that storm is going to come against your house and it's going to collapse completely. It's going to be utterly destroyed, and it's because you failed to build on a solid foundation. In other words, you and I and our lives and our perspectives and our opinions are not nearly as solid as we think they are. As a matter of fact, God says, there again, remember, it's perspective. We talked about that on Sunday. And we all have a different perspective on everything that's going on. And our perspective is our reality. It doesn't mean that it is reality. It's just our reality because of everything that we come and we bring to it. Our perspective on life, on any given circumstance, is our reality. It takes a supernatural act of the work of God to lift us up out of that and to see things from a different perspective. But heaven always has the right perspective. Heaven, in the midst of chaos, still has the right perspective. And God gives us the opportunity, if we will make Jesus the cornerstone of our life, we can have through Christ and only through Christ the ability to see what's going on around us from heaven's perspective. How? Because we use this book as the filter by which we look at everything that we see. Because we're going to do one of two things. We're going to look at the world and everything that's going in it, in that's going on in the world through the filter of God's word, or we're going to use the world as the filter. And we're going to look at the Bible and God through the filter of the world, and we will never get it right if we do that. But if we use at every point in time in our lives and in the circumstance, and it, folks, it doesn't happen accidentally, right? It only happens when we deliberately surrender our lives to Christ, when we force ourselves to take in and sit under and pour over our minds the Word of God. That's the only way. We have to make ourselves do it, because we won't choose to do it otherwise. You know, I have found in the last 2 weeks that I have lost the ability to make some wise choices when it comes to diet and exercise. My wife is, she is an amazing woman, and she convinced me to do this 8-week program with her, and we've got friends and they've had great success, and I was like, okay, let's do it. but I really didn't want to. And I have gone to bed every night having blown it for that day, determined not to blow it the next day. And I have blown it every day. I mean, we're like 10 days into this thing, and I haven't done one day yet. Having good intentions doesn't get it done. It takes willful discipline and determination and diligence and strength to make changes in any area of life. And if it's that hard, folks, if it's that hard to discipline our bodies, how much more difficult is it for us to lean on Christ so that our old nature is crucified? I mean, the struggles that I have faced in the last 10 days with wanting to, on some level, at least so I didn't get in trouble with her, but I haven't even really cared about that. You know, but that's only temporary. And what God is trying to do is eternal. And I'm only really fighting myself and my own flesh and my own desires and my own mindset when it comes to this 8-week deal. And I'm fighting me, I'm fighting my mind, I'm fighting my heart, I'm fighting my flesh, I'm fighting the world, I'm fighting Satan, and all of those things spiritually to walk with God. And so often we forget that, and we think that we can just lollygag along, and we think that just coming to church once or twice a week and that kind of stuff is going to see us through, and we are getting our butts kicked. And we go to bed every night saying, I'm going to do better tomorrow. I'm going to make Jesus the cornerstone of my life tomorrow. I got off track, and I see that, and I know that, and I'm going to do better. And that's awesome. But so many of us do that every day, but there's no substance behind it. There's no determination. Not to do it in our own strength, but determined to surrender to Jesus. Because every day that we live over here doing this stuff and doing it in our own way, we know we fail. We don't stand a chance. There is no hope. And we go to bed looking back on our life on any given day that we've chosen to live that way, and we know that we screwed up, that we failed over and over again because we were trying to do it in our own strength and our own power with our own choices, and we fail and we fail and we fail, right? And we know on some level, at least informationally, right, that we got to turn to Jesus. We got to surrender to Him. We got to lean into Him. We've got to surrender to Him. We've got to relinquish control to Him, because we can't do it. And we wake up every morning and we begin that day like we did the day before. And here's the reality. If we do that, you'll never get a different result than what you already got. Right? Somebody, and I don't know who, but it's definitely true, the definition of insanity, and it's not Webster's dictionary definition of insanity, but it's a real definition of insanity, and it has found its home in the church. You can't do the same thing over and over again and expect a different result. That's insane that we would keep doing the same things over and over again and expect a different result. Now, if you like the result you're getting, then just keep doing what you were doing. But if you know that what you were getting and the outcome of what you were doing isn't what it ought to be and that there's more, then you have to do something different because you can't get more and you can't get changed by continuing to do the same thing over and over again. You're just going to keep getting the same thing over and over again. And so for you and me, if we're going to make a difference, if I'm going to start day 11 and finish these last 6.5 weeks and come remotely close to anything that I should have, I can't do tomorrow what I did today. I can't drink what I drank. I can't eat what I ate. I can't not exercise. I haven't been able to work out today. And so I can't do tomorrow like I did today and get a different result than I have. And I can't do that spiritually. I can't do that as a husband. I can't do that as a father. I can't do that as a pastor. I can't do that as a preacher. I can't do that as a man. It just doesn't work. And so we have to remember that God has given us the cornerstone. God is the one that said, this is what you need. I made you. I didn't make a mistake. And when I made you and placed you where I wanted you in the time that I wanted you to look like I wanted you to look, to be gifted the way that I wanted you to be, I made you exactly the way that I want you to be. And this is what you have to understand, that I know better than you what's best for you. And this is what's best for you, Jesus. And putting him in the right place in your life. Now I know that I'm preaching to the choir, as it were, because you guys are the most faithful and you serve and you do so much at this church. And so what I'm wanting to do tonight is to give you some ammunition to use, not against, not as a club to beat up on somebody else, but as something that you can use as an encouragement to remind people of how important Jesus is. But here's the reality. Until you firmly fix Jesus as your cornerstone, your life is going to ebb and flow between the foundations. And can you really build anything above the foundation until you have settled once and for all what the foundation is going to be? I mean, some people that I know have been a part of the church and been saved for 30, 40, 50 years, and they've never built anything with their life. And the reason is because they floundered and they fluctuated. They went back and forth between what the foundation was going to be. And here's the reality, is it takes a long enough time to build a good structure once you have settled the foundation. Right? And if you are honest in your life and in your own heart and mind, and God is speaking to you now, and what he's revealing to you is that you're still wishy-washy about the foundation that you're going to build on, listen to the language. You still haven't begun to build. You got to settle. God is leading us, leading you, leading your family to once and all settle forever. That defining moment decision that settles forever. Now, it doesn't mean that you're never going to get off course, because builders get off, right? There are times where you start putting up a wall and it's not square and you got to move it or tear it down and start over, right? But you're building. You're not still trying to figure out what the foundation is going to be. You're building, so you're making great progress there, right? So don't be afraid of failures in that, but will you tonight take God's perspective of your life and that he has given you, as it says in verse 7, put and go down there to that very last slide, that this precious value. And think of the way, just in this chapter alone, that God has referenced the gift that he has given us in Christ. And again, he reminds us in the beginning of verse 7, this Jesus is precious. There's nothing greater. It's not a detriment to your life. You're not going to run in a deficit in your life building on Jesus. Because he is precious and he is valuable. And think of how valuable you and I are in God's perspective if he's giving you the precious gift of Jesus. Think of how amazing God views you and me, how awesome God thinks the church is, how valuable God sees humanity if he is giving us Jesus. Does that make y'all sad? I mean, I didn't even get a sneeze or a grunt. I mean, this is something that in our human minds we can't even fully grasp in this life. How amazing, how awesome, how precious Jesus is. And God doesn't think less of you. God couldn't think more of you than to give you Jesus. The value is not of any given thing, ultimately, is not determined by the person who owns it. The ultimate value is determined by what someone is willing to pay for it. And God looked at you and said, the price that I'm willing to pay for you is the life of my son. That's how valuable you are to God. That's how valuable we are to God. The person on this planet that you despise most, that is how valuable they are to God. That's why it takes a supernatural work of God, because God sees value in people that you and I don't see value in. Because they've hurt us, or they've cheated us, or they've robbed us, or they've offended us, or whatever, they've disagreed with us, or whatever the case may be. But we tend to people that we allow ourselves to be separated from because of circumstances that happen. I just want you to know, because you don't value them doesn't mean God doesn't. And anyone that you would look at and not value the way God does, it's not a God problem, it's a you problem. And in that area, you've made yourself the cornerstone, not Jesus. You've assumed the throne again of your heart and your life and your mind towards that person, and you can't be right with God as long as you feel that way. Because God loves them as much as he loves you. And it doesn't, God's not looking on the outward appearance, right? That's what we look at. That's what man looks at. That's what we judge by. God doesn't do that. God looks at me and you and anybody else, and he looks through the outward man. He looks at the heart and the mind of a person. God judges the heart. And so how do we adjust? By making Jesus our cornerstone, by making Jesus the one that we cling to, by making Jesus the one that we allow to knit our lives together so that our life actually has meaning. You see, the world is full of people who are wandering around aimlessly And they may be doing a lot of stuff, but their life has no purpose. Their life has no meaning. And in those things, that many of them would say, I don't even feel like I'm valuable. Why? Because they've never come to know the one who created them and made them valuable. And you, no one can understand their value. No one can understand their purpose. No one can understand the reason why they're here until and unless they come to know Christ. And that's why you and I, as Christians, are still here. It's so that we can take Jesus to them. Because without Christ, they're going to build a life that will ultimately crumble because a storm is coming. And anybody say, been through a storm? Another one's coming. I don't know when, I don't know where, I don't know how, I don't know how long, but I can tell you this, life happens every day. And it'll make a difference when the storm comes, whether you've built on the rock or whether you built on the sand. He's precious. Greatly, greatly precious. I'm going to stop right there because I had no intention. That is not at all what I intended to do tonight, but that's where the Lord led me as I got going, and what I intended to do, I don't have time to do tonight. And so we're going to stop right there, and we'll pick this up next Wednesday night, and I'll do next week what I prepared and planned to do tonight. So let's pray. Father, thank you. You are precious. You are amazing. You are wonderful. God, it blows my mind, and I know it boggles the minds of many that you would look at me, that you would look at them, that you would look at us and see anything valuable at all. Lord, we do not understand the cross, but we thank you for it. God, we don't understand why you would save us, but thank you that you do. There's nothing that we could ever do to live good enough to earn what you have given us through Jesus freely. It truly is the unmerited favor of God, and we rejoice in it, and we celebrate it, and we thank you for it, and we worship you. And God, I pray that we would live the rest of this week lifting up Jesus, because when Jesus Christ is lifted up, he'll draw men and women and boys and girls to himself, that they might be saved, that they might be redeemed, that maybe they might be forgiven, that they might find for the first time ever the purpose and the meaning of their life because of Christ. Lord, I pray that even as Christians, that we would pursue you and allow you to pursue us in such a way that we would grow in our understanding of how valuable we are to you, of how great your love is for us, of how precious Jesus is, and how eternally magnificent your plan is for our lives. God, I pray that as we see it, that in absolute and utter amazement, we would surrender more and more and more to you so that your will can be done on earth just like it is in heaven. We love you, Lord. Thank you for loving us the way that you do. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.